The title of my talk is Basis of Gene Therapy for the Treatment of Leukemias. And I'll try to give you a general overview and some of our experience on cancer immunotherapy. It is clear that T cells, T lymphocytes, are really powerful tool to treat cancer. In the allogeneic stem cell transplantation, which is actually the treatment of choice for patients with high-risk hematological malignancies, and in particular for patients with acute leukemias, the transfer of T lymphocytes from a healthy donor together with hematopoietic stem cells induce an immunological reaction against leukemia cells named the graft-versus-leukemia effect, which is really beneficial and possibly the cause of the long-term remission in these patients. But on the other hand, the same T lymphocytes, by recognizing healthy tissue in the patient, mediate graft-versus-host disease, a detrimental and potentially lethal complication of allogeneic stem cell transplantation. So we have efficacy, but we have a problem related to toxicity. Conversely, in the autologous setting, mainly adopted for the treatment of solid tumors such as melanoma, it became clear that it is possible to isolate T lymphocytes specific for cancer antigen from a cancer patient, from a patient with cancer, to reinfuse these cells to the patient. And upon conditioning, upon previous conditioning, this infusion results in very strong and often persistent clinical response, so again, efficacy. But also in this setting in which GVHD doesn't occur, we have a problem to face. And the problem is limited applicability. For very few patients, we are able really to isolate these tumor-specific T cells, and mainly this approach has been confined to the treatment of melanoma. So we believe that gene transfer tools and gene therapy might allow to overcome all the limitations of adoptive T-cell therapy, such as toxicity by expressing suicide genes in donor lymphocytes, for example, or such as feasibility. For those patients in which it is not possible to isolate tumor-specific T-cells, it is indeed possible to transfer the genes encoding for cancer-specific receptors, such as the T-cell receptor or chimeric receptors, so to generate, engineer tumor-specific T-cells to treat the patients. And these will be the topic of my presentation today. And I'll start with suicide gene therapy, which has been one of the first clinical applications of gene transfer in adoptive immunotherapy. The concept is really simple. We can isolate T cells from a stem cell donor, hematopoietic stem cell donor, transduce them to express a suicide gene, select them thanks to the expression of a cell surface marker, and then reinfuse them to a transplanted patient. So in this case, what we aim to obtain is a graft-versus infection effect, so to provide a rapid immune reconstitution to the patient so that the patient will be able to defend himself from infections, to enforce a graft-versus leukemia effect. And since we didn't deplete it for the alloreactive specificity, we know we might expect to observe some graft-versus-host disease, and if this occurs, we will exploit the suicide machinery by administering ganciclovir, which is the product that kills cells expressing the TK suicide gene. We will eliminate selectively the gene-modified cells and obtain a remission of graft-versus-host disease. This approach has been developed in the 90s and tested clinically at first in San Raffaele in Milano. Is today an approach that has been tested worldwide in Europe, in the US, in Asia, so in several centers, and in different clinical contexts to treat disease relapse occurring after transplant or to prevent disease relapse and to promote immune reconstitution in the context of haploidentical stem cell transplantation. And the last two trials, the TK007 trial and the ongoing TK008 trial, are applied in the haploidentical setting and have been sponsored by MolMed. And this reminds me to declare my conflict of interest. I have a research contract with this company. So it is really a widely spread gene therapy approach, and by relatively big number for a T-cell, for a cell-based gene therapy approach, we may really learn a lot of important things for all the gene therapy fields. So the first thing we can clearly say is that the approach is feasible and safe. So T-cell gene therapy is a feasible approach. We have more than 120 patients treated in 10 different trials, and we never observed any adverse events related to gene transfer, to the gene transfer procedure in any of these patients, with a substantial cumulative follow-up and 25 patients with more than 5 years follow-up. The second important observation we made is that TK cells are indeed effective in promoting graft versus infection and graft versus tumor effect, and this activity has been clearly observed both in the HLA identical and in the haploidentical setting. And finally, the TK machinery, the TK gun cyclery machinery, so the suicide machinery, is really effective in controlling graft versus host disease. None of the patients who have been treated with TK cells in any of the clinical trials has ever progressed in GVHD or ever needed a long-term immunosuppressive treatment. This is really different from what is usually observed in patients transplanted and receiving regular, untransduced, unmanipulated lymphocytes. So the machinery is really robust. Now, what else can we learn from this trial? I think that we have also some more basic questions that we can learn in these patients. We have a cell surface marker expressed on T lymphocytes that allow us to unambiguously recognize the cells that we have infused and to recognize them by cytofluorimetric analysis to characterize the cells, also years after the treatment. And we have the retroviral integration that allows, again, to unambiguously track at a clonal level infused T cells. And we're currently exploiting these two features to try to understand more about how T cell gene therapy can be improved, how does it work, and what is really the dynamic of immunological memory that could guide us in improving the efficacy of T-cell-based gene therapy. So we can. The questions that we asked are here listed. What is the mechanism of action of TK cells? We have a direct graft versus tumor, graft versus infection effect, which is exactly the mechanism that we were looking for when we infused the cells. But we also have indirect effect that might occur and that we might reveal by studying the cells. And the second important issue, the second important question is, can TK cells really survive long term? These are cells that have been activated in vitro, they've been cultured, they've been genetically modified, they changed their phenotype and their function. They started from being naive, some of these cells were not antigen experienced, but they all become memory cells. So can we really generate cells that are not only able to mediate therapeutic effect, but persist in the patient and provide the long-term immunological survey that we really need for abate cancer cells. Starting from the first issue, the direct effect of TK cells have been shown by first identifying the patients who had a benefit from the infusion. This is a slide from a series of patients who were treated in San Raffaele for leukemia relapse occurring after transplant. And as you can see, patients with complete remission or partial remission are had clearly a higher expansion of TK cells as compared to patients with no response, really suggesting that when TK cells, when genetically modified cells are infused and then expand, then they mediate a clinical effect. This direct effect was also studied more analytically on single patients. This is a patient who received, was one of the first patients who received TK cells in this same trial. She had a chronic myelomonocytic leukemia, was transplanted. In her bone marrow, we observed the reappearance of the disease, here the black part of the pie, and we infused TKDLI. We observed an increase in the peripheral blood of TK cells. And this was concomitant both to clinical remission of disease, but also with graft-versus-host disease. So this patient received ganciclovir, had a complete response of graft-versus-host disease, but then we observed a clear reduction of circulating TK cells. But then TK cells were still present in the peripheral blood at lower levels and became always detectable, but always at lower and lower frequencies, until while the patient continued to remain in complete remission of disease, really suggesting that these cells were playing a role in controlling the disease. Of course, another possibility is that these cells and the transplant itself was able to completely eradicate the disease, and we really don't need these cells anymore, and the job has been done. Unfortunately, that was not the case for this patient. At 14 years after the infusion, we started not observing the cells anymore. We couldn't detect them. They were present, but possibly at a lower level than that, than the threshold of even of PCR. And the patient relapsed. She relapsed of exactly the same disease. Indeed, the cells were present at a lower level, were not completely abrogated. We could retrieve them because this patient received cells that express also the neomycin resistance gene, so we could select the cells in vitro and observe that they were mainly CD4 cells, even though we had infused mainly CD8 cells. So CD8 might be the one that we have lost predominantly. And the patient then received a second transplant from an unrelated donor and is now alive and well anyway, in complete remission. But the other important thing that this observation taught us, is the fact that genetically modified cells can really persist long term. This is really 14 years, which was, in a sense, unexpected. This for the direct effect. What about the indirect effect, the unpredicted effect? In the TK007 trial, there is a phase 1-2 trial in which we infused TK cells in patients receiving a T-cell-depleted haploidentical transplant, and we infused these cells because these patients, especially if they are adults, such as in our case, remain completely immunosuppressed for as much as a year after a T-depleted transplant. And most of them die of infections because of this. So we decided to infuse TK cells to promote immune reconstitution. And by following this patient, we really bumped in an indirect, unexpected indirect effect. Now, in this trial, with a median age of 50 years, so patients with a really low thymic function because of the age, we infused TK cells. And we observed that in patients in which TK cells engrafted, we had a very prompt and robust immune reconstitution. In a few months after transplant, we observed circulating TK cells, while in those patients in which TK cells didn't engraft, or patients who did not receive TK cells, here are the number of circulating T cells. So we really were pushing the immune reconstitution. And this was what we wanted and what was expected. The immune reconstitution, I would also like to say, was very effective, since we had in the immune reconstituted patient an abatement of infectious diseases, infectious complication of the transplant, while, of course, in patients with no immune reconstitution, infections were the main problem, and none of them survived more than 7 months because of infections. So this is what was what we expected and we hoped to see. But the surprise came when we looked at the phenotype of TK cells. By exploiting the cell surface marker on the green TK transduced cells, we could observe in untreated patients that the majority of the circulating T lymphocytes were actually not TK positive, were not expressing the LNGFR. They were TK negative. So we were infusing a pure population of genetically modified cells and ended up having a lot of unmodified lymphocytes. And indeed, these lymphocytes were not transduced. They did not have any sign of integration. So they were really unmodified lymphocytes. And by studying these lymphocytes for their naive versus memory phenotype, we observed that some of these cells had a naive phenotype. We know that TK cells are all memory cells. So really these TK negative cells were something different that we could observe only when we infused TK cells. So Luca Vago and Giacomo Oliveira in the lab decided to try to understand this phenomenon. And they started by what is known about post-transplant immunoreconstitution. Naive T cells in a transplanted patient might arise from the homeostatic expansion of cells infused with the transplant, of T cells infused in the with the transplant, or maybe contaminants of our TK cells in our case. They might expand in the host and reconstitute the patient. But naive cells can also originate from the thymus, from hematopoietic precursors of donor origin that become T-cell, differentiate to T-cell precursor, and then are educated in the thymus to be tolerant to the host. So they bet on this hypothesis and looked for it. And to look for it, they analyzed the number of circulating naive T-cells, CD4 cells, expressing CD31, which is a marker of recent thymic emigrants. So when thymocytes are mature and they have to aggress from the thymus to the periphery, they do express CD31, which is actually a molecule used to aggress from the thymus. And as soon as they start proliferating homeostatically, they lose the marker. And what Luca and Giacomo observed was that in the TK trial, essentially all, virtually all the naive T cells observed at time of immunoreconstitution are indeed recent thymic emigrants. And they are much more than the cells that are observed before the transplant or in age-matched control. Really suggesting that the infusion of effector TK cells was promoting a renew of thymopoiesis. They went on and tried to see what could be the molecules involved in this phenomenon, and they focused on IL-7 because this is really a molecule very important for T-cell homeostasis, but also for thymopoiesis. And indeed, they observed the serum level of IL-7s in patients after transplant. Usually, because of T-cell depletion after transplant, we have a peak of IL-7, but then this peak goes down. And what they observe is that after TK cell infusion, we had a second peak of IL-7 that was then lost when T-cells arise and increase in the peripheral blood, possibly because of consumption of IL-7 itself. So they ended up with a model in which they realized that TK cells can mediate a direct effect, and they are the real player of alloreactivity and of graft versus leukemia, since they're not tolerant to the host. But they also drive a thymic recovery through IL-7 production, and this generates new TK-negative cells, which will now be tolerant to the host, so will not give rise to graft versus host disease, but will be able to promote the long-term immunoreconstitution in the patient. And indeed, also some clinical observation suggested that this was really the situation that we were observing, because despite the fact TK cells represented a small fraction of the circulating T cells in this group of patients, actually in all the patients who experienced GVHD, the treatment with ganciclovir, so the elimination of TK cells, here in green, resulted in control of GVHD, even though the TK negative cells remained very abundant in the peripheral blood, really indicating that alloreactivity in this patient is clustered within the TK positive cells. And when they looked at immunoreconstitution, for example, by studying the frequency of CMV specific T cells in the circulation, they observed that this frequency, of course, increased after treatment, and this increase is not lost in patients who are treated with ganciclovir to treat graft-versus-host disease, nor the rate of infections is increased in this patient. Again, indicating that immunoreconstitution long-term is really maintained through the TK-negative counterpart. So this is really an indirect effect that we observe. The question that we recently asked was that of how persistent is this effect? So we looked at recent thymic emigrants in TK patients surviving more than 5 years after transplant. They are this dot in red. And we observed that actually this effect is really sustained. Even 7, 10 years after transplant, the patients still have an increased time of poiesis as compared to age-matched control. So it's really a persistent effect. So this is the picture that we have in mind now. How do TK cells work? We infuse TK cells after transplant. Some of them are alloreactive. If they will give rise to graft-versus-host disease, we will have to eliminate them with ganciclovir. Some others are non-alloreactive with other specificities, possibly also some cancer-specific specificity or viral specificity. The infusion in the patient promote time of poiesis, so we will have also some blue TK negative cells. And this will be the specificities and kind of cells that we will have long term in patients. So the question that Giacomo asked recently was, how many TK cells do we have at this point in the long term when the patient has really achieved the resting condition, is in complete remission, is not lymphodepleted anymore? Do we still have these TK cells? Can they make it to stay and promote an effect? And he started studying this cohort of patients. Our initial hypothesis was yes, we expect them to be there, and we expect them to be there because we know that the major power of T cells is persistence. I think that the ability of T cells to persist, of memory T cells to persist after a primary infection, after encountering the antigen, is actually the most important feature that we can exploit if we want to translate this experimental form of therapy in to become a really widely used form of therapy, because no small molecule antibody or chemotherapeutic agent can stay so long in a patient. So really becoming a sort of dynamic therapy within the patient. So our bet was, yes, they should be there. Let's see which kind of cells remain, and let's exploit them to have more effective adoptive T-cell therapy. And indeed, we started by analyzing the fact that T cells are not identical one to the other. They start antigen inexperienced, naive. Then when they encounter the antigen, they differentiate, and then they can become central memory cells or the hierarchically superior and recently described stem memory cells, or they can become effectors. And effector cells are actually highly potent in killing the target, but prone to die, while central memory and stem memory cells are expected to remain in the secondary lymphoid organ and being able to differentiate again, but also self-renew upon an antigen encounter. And we might study these cells thanks to the expression of cell surface markers, CD62L, the two isoform of CD45 array, and FAS, which is expressed only by memory cells. And of course, also by looking at their effector function. Of course, early differentiated cells will produce mainly IL-2, which is required for survival of the cells, while interferon, cytotoxicity will be a characteristic of effector cells. So Giacomo started by studying these 14 patients. There are 14 patients treated in San Raffaele, all in complete remission of disease, complete remission of graft-versus-host disease, alive and well after TK cells at 3 to 14 years, so a median of 9 years after TK cell infusions. And the first question he asked was, do we still see TK cells in this patient? And the answer was yes. Indeed, here are two examples of peripheral blood of patients treated in which a small fraction of T cells do express the NGFR marker. So he could sort the cells, look at the CD4-CD8 ratio, look at the phenotype. and some of them had expressed the CD62L and CD45 array markers, which are usually considered the markers of naive cells, but they're actually all CD95 positive, fast positive. So actually these cells are stem memory T cells. They're all gun cycle, all the different population were sorted and we observed that they're all gun cycle were sensitive. In terms of ability to proliferate, so Ki67 expression, they're very similar to the TK negative fraction, so they proliferate at very low level in the peripheral blood. Possibly the proliferating ones are the one in tissues. And here is a full picture of the first patients in which in 9 out of 10 we could detect the TK cells. Always at very low levels, with one, just one exception. And I want to point out that also in this, when the cells were present at such a low levels in which we were not really sure what we were looking at, Giacomo was able to sort the cells and by repeated stimulation and selection through LNGFR expression end up with stem memory, central memory, and effector memory cells all expressing the marker. So they're really cells able to proliferate. So this allows us really to do a T-cell dynamic study and to evaluate which of these cells is superior in terms of ability to expand. So in other words, if we see an effector cells at 14 years after the infusion, is this effector cells present because it was infused as effector and is actually able to expand and persist for 14 years? Or does it come from a stem memory cells that was infused at day zero and that will be then able to differentiate? And this is not just a basic question, it's a relevant question, because if we really find that a specific subset is the one that is on the basis, is the hierarchically superior to the other, it is the one on the basis that promote persistence of the cells, we have to focus on that cell subset to have an effective and protective and long-term protective immunotherapy. So he started by studying TK cells that were infused and observed that essentially all there were infused mainly effector, but also central memory and stem memory cells were infused. And he looked at what we see now in the patient. This is a summary of the patients, and as you can see here, while the TK negative cells in long-term patients are mainly naive, and there are some central memory and stem memory, the TK positive cells that were all memory at infusion are progressively enriched in stem memory and central memory cells. So what we're doing now, thanks to the collaboration with Manfred Schmidt and Christoph von Kahl, is to study these single cells sorted at different time points and trying to reconstruct the hierarchy of the of T cell memory in patients. So as I said, our aim is really not only to have the answer, but to exploit the answer and then genetically modify cells to have them more effective. We are able to genetically modify stem memory T cells, not only central memory and effector cells. This was work of Nicoletta Ceri in the lab by sorting naive cells and co-stimulating them and culture them with IL-7 and IL-15. We end up with stem memory T cells that are much superior to other cells in different in the ability to expand, but also in the self-renewal abilities in mice. And how can we transduce them? Of course, we can express suicide gene, but we can also try to redirect them against cancer antigen and exploit them not only in the allogenic, but also in the autologous setting. And why do we need to genetically modify a T cell and to redirect it against the tumor antigen? Because actually, cancer cells are very similar to normal cells. And so to avoid autoimmunity, our thymus tend to delete those T cells that are able to recognize at with high avidity a cancer antigen, because a cancer antigen is usually also a self-antigen, maybe confined in its expression, level of expression and tissue expression, but still an autoantigen. So usually what we end up is a T cell that express very low level of a TCR, so it's low has a low avidity against cancer cells, or T cells that, that express TCR and make them specific for a known cancer antigen. So we really need to engineer the cells to make a tumor-specific T cell. And we can engineer these cells by different ways. One possibility is TCR gene transfer, which has been actually developed and tested clinically. And here are some of the results of clinical trials, all performed in the US with TCR gene transfer, the TCR gene transfer approach. Some of these really produced relevant results, such as the NYSO1 study. Still, these are not really results as good, as intense as the one that were observed with naturally occurring tumor-specific T cells. And that might have to do with the structure, the biology of the genetically modified cells. If you see here, when we do an expansion of a naturally occurring tumor-specific lymphocytes, we start from a bulk population, all of these cells express different TCR, and we enrich for the T cell expressing the green TCR, the tumor-specific TCR. When we do a TCR gene transfer, we actually transfer the genes encoding for this TCR in T cells that still express the endogenous one. So we will end up with T cells that will express four different TCR: the tumor-specific one, which is the green one, the endogenous one, different color in different cells, and also possible mispaired TCR. Mispaired TCR coming from one chain of the endogenous TCR and one chain of the tumor-specific TCR. And these T cells might actually be autoreactive because they were not educated in the thymus. They just came out randomly because of the transduction. So we have clearly a problem of toxicity, of potential toxicity due to the autoreactivity of the mispaired one, but also a problem of efficacy, because if we look at the number of TCR molecules, of tumor-specific TCR molecules, that we have expressed in T cells, there are really few as compared to the ones that we could achieve in naturally occurring T cells. And this might explain the reduced rate of clinical responses observed with TCR gene transfer up to now. Or at least this is what we reasoned, and with Luigi Naldini and colleagues of Sangamo Biosciences, we designed a different approach based on the use of zinc finger nucleases to knock down the genes encoding for the endogenous TCR. So make T cells really naked, unable to express the endogenous TCR, and then transfer by lentiviral vector, so permanently, the tumor-specific TCR. So by this approach, we end up with T cells really expressing a single TCR, the one that we have selected. Functionally, phenotypically, they're really identical to naturally occurring T cells. And indeed, when we tested these cells in mice in which we infused primary leukemias, we observed that while mice receiving TCR transfer cells had a good response of the leukemia but died of graft-versus-host disease because of the expression of the endogenous TCR and of the mispaired TCR, mice receiving the TCR-edited cells had a very good clinical response in the absence of GVHD, because they're really behaving like clones. This approach is a really time-consuming approach. It's a 45 days. It's not that long as compared to general T-cell therapy, but still it's longer than what we would like to have. It's not really user-friendly. And recently, Sara Mastaglio in the lab has developed a simplified protocol of single editing, in which she knocked down one endogenous gene and then complemented with the tumor-specific TCR. This is a 14 days, 10 to 14 days long approach that we really think is much more similar to for time and reagents to the TK approach. So we really think that it will go to the clinic soon. And I'm not going to show you this data, and I hope you will come and hear the more recent result with the TCR gene transfer gene editing approach tomorrow in the oral session of cancer gene therapy. An alternative to TCR gene transfer is actually the use of chimeric antigen receptors. These are molecules that have been really designed and engineered for the first time by Zeli Gescher, and I'm really happy to remind you that this year he will receive for this very important discovery the outstanding award of the European Society of Cell and Gene Therapy, so be there. These receptors are very similar to TCR for the signal transduction domain, but they do recognize the antigen like antibodies. So they are non-MHC restricted, they do not require antigen processing, they can recognize also lipid and sugar antigens, all characteristics that they do not share with this receptor. The characteristics that they actually share with antibodies, but they share with TCR gene transfer all the positive aspect of T cells, so biodistribution, ability to persist, to expand, all characteristics that antibodies do not actually have. So they're really interesting approaches. They've been tested mainly in clinical trials to target B cell malignancies. And I'm sure you will hear much more of this approach during this meeting, both at the cancer immunotherapy sessions and during Zelig's presentation. And I will just end up by showing what we have achieved in San Raffaele. This is the work of Monica Casucci and Attilio Bondanza, who developed a new chimeric antigen receptor targeting CD44V6. This is a molecule expressed by acute leukemias and multiple myeloma. And by expressing this chimeric antigen receptor in T cells harvested from a patient with leukemia, he observed that he could, by infusing these genetically modified T cells in mice that were engrafted with the same leukemia of the same patient, he could achieve eradication of the disease with no AML cells in the peripheral blood nor in the spleen. So I hope you will hear him tomorrow during the session. And I'll end up by thanking all the people involved in this work. I think I've mentioned all of them during the presentation, but I would also like to show you how the TK consortium, the TK008 consortium is made of. This is a consortium of clinical centers who are testing TK cells in a randomized phase 3 trial in which haploidentical transplantation is performed in the presence or absence of TK cells, and the endpoint is to see whether the infusion of genetically modified cells makes a difference for disease-free survival, which is actually the most important question we need to answer to really transform this therapy from an experimental phase to a clinical reality. And I'd like to thank you for your attention.
Okay, thank you, Chiara. Is there any question in the audience for Dr. Bonini?
So, very nice talk. I was sort of curious, many of the ex vivo conditions for expanding T cells often drive or maintain central memory function. Do you think that there just needs to be more work with regards to how to genetically manipulate T cells and expand them ex vivo to sort of prolong or maintain the sort of stem central memory phenotype?
Thank you for this question, which is really important, I believe. We've been looking at that, and we don't have a complete answer today, at least. For sure, co-stimulation, so using beads with anti-CD3 and anti-CD28 or other co-stimulus, permit to recruit in cell cycle also naive T cells, so cells that are prone, able to become central memory and stem memory cells. For sure, IL-7 and IL-15 promotes the expansion of cells without differentiation in effector cells. So I would go for this. And if we start from sorted naive T cells as opposed to old T cells, so memory and naive, we have a clear enrichment of a pure population, more than 80%, let's say, pure of stem memory T cells in these conditions. But still, we have some central memory and stem memory pretty much in all the manipulation protocol that we have. So the question today, if we study them in models, PBL transduced or naive cells transduced are really different. In animal models, I can have engraftment in secondary transplant only when I start from naive cells and I have a pure population of stem memory. The few stem memory that I generate in PBL are not able to do this. Whether this is a quantitative issue or also a qualitative issue on some markers that we don't know yet, that's, I think, an open question. If I had to choose and I did not have any problem of budget, I would definitely go for the naive today.
Okay. I guess my other question is, the alternative would be whether it be possible to reinfuse patients with genetically modified cells once they've actually relapsed. You had one patient after 14 years relapsed. Would it be possible instead to sort of reinfuse cells that you might have had left over? Obviously, there's complications with regards to storing cells that long, but.
So in a, let's say, theoretically, you could, especially after 14 years, because in a way, this leukemia was controlled by the cells in 14 years. Let's say that this will become more easy when TK cells will be available also outside clinical trials, because in a way, you're really doing something different from what you declared in the trial, and that's the reason why we didn't do it. Another question is, and we stayed on this question so much with all the clinical group, is it's true that the leukemia of these patients was controlled for 14 years, but then it relapsed. So should we use the same donor? Should we go for moral reactivity? So at the end, we decided in the middle. So we changed the donor, but we did not use a haploidentical donor, which is the strongest in terms of alloreactivity, but also of risks. And we selected the MUD, so HLA identical, but for sure much more diverse for minor antigens. She is still in complete remission, let's hope. It's a couple of years now.
Okay, so if I might ask another question. So you have demonstrated very clearly that you can have long-term persistence of TK-positive cells, at least to some levels. But you know there is a concern about the immunogenicity of TK. And there are some alternatives being developed. So what is your opinion about that? Do you think that TK is still a immunogenicity against TK is still a problem and it's just a quantitative issue? So you lose most of the cells, but you still retain some of them. What do you think about that?
Yeah, I think, in those patients in which we observed the development of an immune response against TK, most of them, the TK cells disappeared, and these are actually not studied in this trial. We confirmed this, but they were out of the study. But for most of patients, by infusing early after transplant, so in a condition in which during the infusion, the patient is unable to mount a new response, we did not induce an immune response against TK. Mm-hmm. And in this patient, the fact of the persisting cells are actually evidently not able to prime T cells. They need to die to present the antigen so that the antigen is taken up by APC and then the response starts. In this absence, there is, I wouldn't say tolerance because you can break it, but there is ignorance, actually. There was a paper from Katia Traversari a few years ago on this, and we still see the same event in the long-term patients.
Okay, thank you. So if there is no other questions, so we'll move to the next talk.